What is a virus? How do vaccines work? And how might phage save humanity? Come learn this and more real science with a narrative from Star Trek Voyager right here. Hello, I'm Mohammed Noor. I'm a professor of biology at Duke University, and I'm an occasional science consultant for the Star Trek universe. I'm very excited to talk with you today about viruses, vaccines, and how these things work using examples from an episode of Star Trek Voyager called Phage from the first season. So let's dive right in. So in this episode, the crew is beamed down to an asteroid, and they're in a cavern searching for some mineral. Now, while they're down there, our friend Neelix, who's a Talaxian, has his lungs stolen through some advanced medical technology. Now, it turns out that a species called the Vidians did this. They look a little bit like zombies. And they did this apparently because they're infected with a virus they call a phage. So here's some dialogue from the episode. One Vidian says, "We are gathering replacement organs and suitable biomatter. It is the only way we have to fight the phage." Captain Janeway says, "A virus? Some kind of disease?" The second Vidian says, "Yes, it attacked our people over 2 millennia ago. It consumes our bodies, destroys our genetic codes and cellular structures." So let's break this down. First of all, what is a virus? Well, a virus is barely more than a small, simple set of self-assembly instructions in a capsule. It's really not much more than a bit of DNA or RNA with a few proteins in a small envelope. And it acts kind of like a computer virus, but it's made of DNA or RNA. Now, what it does is it infects cells from living species, and it causes them to make more viruses. Now, viruses can't reproduce on their own, and therefore many consider them not to be really alive. Now, doctors do talk about, quote-unquote, killing viruses, but what they mean is destroying them or making them non-infectious. And again, like a computer virus, a biological virus takes over things it infects, but it's really barely more than the instructions itself. So let's dig in a little bit more detail and use bacteriophage, or quote-unquote phage, as a first example. Now, phage are viruses that typically attack bacteria. In fact, they don't attack animal cells, but they still kill tons of bacteria everywhere. They're massive bacteria killers. Now, phage are everywhere. There are tons of them in seawater. They're all over about every liquid and every surface, including all over your skin, too. But let's talk about what they do. First, a phage will attach itself to the outside of a bacterium, and it'll insert its DNA or RNA. Now, the code in their DNA or RNA takes over the cell's machinery and causes them to make proteins that the virus needs, as well as more copies of the DNA or RNA. Now, those pieces then get assembled into more viruses and more viruses until eventually they bust out of the bacteria and spread to other bacterial cells. They're kind of crazy. Now, even though phages don't attack animal cells, there are other kinds of viruses that, of course, do attack animal cells. And these are, of course, the viral diseases that we all know. In some cases, the process is pretty similar. They attach and insert the bad code. In other cases, the whole virus actually gets into the cell somehow, and it takes over the cellular machinery. Now, the body's defenses do try to fight off viruses. So you make antibodies, and I'm going to talk more about antibodies in just a second. And you also make proteins that interfere with virus replication. You have what are called killer cells that destroy infected cells before they can infect other cells. And you get fever and other sorts of things that try to slow or stop viruses and more. But viruses can sometimes be super sneaky. So some of them will actually produce proteins that inhibit some of these cell defenses. For example, SARS-CoV-2, which is associated with the COVID-19 disease that a lot of people are talking or thinking about at the time this video is recorded, it actually inserts a couple of proteins that inhibit cell defenses too. And other viruses will slow or stop reproducing in your cells, but they'll be hiding and waiting to launch an attack later. So the chickenpox virus is one example of one that does this. So let's talk for a moment about antibodies and vaccines. First, an antibody. What does an antibody do? Well, your body makes antibodies naturally after it's exposed to a virus. So after you're infected, the cells in your body identify something unusual about proteins on the viruses that are infecting you. Then your immune system will create a custom-made antibody protein that attacks that specific kind of virus, binding to some very specific protein on it, and either making it unable to infect cells or maybe putting a target on it for other cells to come destroy it. So if the antibody is effective, you not only kill those viruses, but you also get immunity for some length of time to that virus, since you have now in your body those custom antibodies for that kind of virus. So this connects to vaccines. Now, a vaccine, like say the flu shot, will stimulate your body to make antibodies to the influenza virus. Now, basically, you're injected with like broken influenza viruses, so your body recognizes them and starts making antibodies to that. Now, the problem is that influenza viruses aren't all exactly the same, and the amino acids in some of their proteins change very, very, very fast over time. So from the shot, you might make antibodies to an influenza strain that was abundant in Australia in July, but the influenza strains where you live in, say, Canada or the United Kingdom in October may not be exactly the same. So it's hard to keep up since these changes happen all the time. But you still sometimes get partial immunity. So it's still good to get the flu shot, even if it's not perfect. The antibodies will bind, but maybe not so great because the proteins have changed some, but maybe not all the way. Now, this is one reason we can't eradicate the flu very easily. And as people develop immunity through vaccines or infections, the influenza virus keeps changing, making this ongoing arms race between us and the viruses. Now, this is again why it's important to keep taking new flu shots each year. So coming back to the episode that we're focusing on, the Vidians said it consumes our bodies, it destroys our genetic codes and cellular structures. Now, we talked about how the virus can consume and affect cells, but there's an important piece here that was said about destroying the genetic code. Now, some viruses, and HIV is a notable example, are super sneaky. Not only do they take over the host cell machinery, but they actually slip their genes into the host cell's genome. So if someone's infected, their cells may adopt some of these foreign genes. So the cell keeps making more of the virus and passing on the virus-making instructions as it divides. So in that way, maybe quote unquote destroying their genetic code is happening in the Vidians because the virus keeps inserting some of its genes repeatedly into different places into the Vidian genome. That's pretty bad. Now, in the case of the Vidians, since it invades their genomes, it's quite possible, though not certain, that at least some Vidian children are born with the virus already integrated into their DNA from their parents. Now, it may not be turned on and causing the disease right when they're born, but it will be there and waiting to attack them. Now, I want to close out by mentioning two quick things. First, you may have noticed I didn't mention antibiotics, and that's because antibiotics fight bacteria, not viruses. And we have an ongoing problem that a lot of bacteria have actually evolved immunity to antibiotics, so antibiotics don't even always work on bacteria. However, some scientists are now working on engineering phage viruses to attack the bacteria that antibiotics don't work on anymore. This is called phage therapy. So if you want to look that up, you can Google it. But remember, real phage kill bacteria, but don't hurt animals like us. So while the phage may be terrible for the Vidians, they may end up saving a lot of our species in the future. That's pretty cool, huh? So what did you think of the Vidians and the phage that they were struggling with? Let us know in the comments, and thank you again for tuning into BioTricky Explains. Have a great one. Bye.